Good to see you here this evening. You don't look like you're happy to see me. Well, I can't really tell. Well, glory to God. Amen. What a joy it is to be here this evening, especially to come and feast on the word of God. It said, give us this day, day by day, our daily bread. And this is another opportunity to learn, to be instructed, and to receive that which God has for us. We need to be conscious of the fact that the Holy Spirit is the teacher. The Bible says he will teach us all things and he will lead us into all truth. So even when someone stands to teach, you've got to look beyond the individual. If you don't, you won't be able to receive. So the day that Pastor Nicholas stands to teach, you say, what does he have to say? That's how you lose out on God. If it's someone else, you say, what is not pastor? So God can't speak except it's through Pastor Shola. If someone unfamiliar is leading praise, you say, don't even understand what they are doing. These are some things that rob you of receiving of God's grace. When it became needful, God used a donkey. And I don't want to say you have a Balaamic spirit, because Balaam actually engaged the donkey. At least he had that common sense to have a conversation. The only prophet that has really had a conversation with the donkey, at least it goes down. He used the donkey to speak. Jesus said, if you won't let this one shout, Hosanna, to the Son of David, he said, even the rocks that have built this temple will cry out and praise me. I wish we had seen that happen. I mean, I wish that had become a reality, you know, that inanimate objects will praise him. But you know, again, he wasn't talking to that temple. He was talking about this temple. Because where are the rocks that cry out? Because we're living stones built up onto a spiritual edifice, offering up spiritual sacrifices unto him. Matthew chapter 13 tonight, I really don't know whether we'd be able to truly thrash out everything about the parable of the sower. We may switch into February and just maybe run it during our midweek services. Matthew chapter 13 verse 18, therefore hear the parable of the sower. I was just during praise and worship, my mind just towards the end before I came up went, you know, the Holy Spirit just took my attention to this verse of scripture, and I want to ask you a question. Therefore, hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is he who received seed by the wayside. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom. And the question the Holy Spirit asked me to ask you. Isn't that nice that the Holy Spirit asked me to ask you a question? Is, what if the person or the word the person heard isn't the word of the kingdom? So answer, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom, what if what the person hears is not the word of the kingdom? Would it be considered seed? It It is still seed. But it is what? Corruptible seed. So if you look at what Paul writes in 1 Peter, Jesus is so narrowed down on the word of the kingdom, and he shares this parable as if no other word exists. It's too focused upon the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom. The kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom very often has become the kingdoms of men instead of the kingdom of God. A pastor said something. He said, he once read a book titled The Man God Uses. How many of you have read that book? It's a very popular book. If you were born again in the 80s, you probably would come on. Oswald Chambers. He said, it feels like writing a book titled The God Man Uses. I know you didn't get it. The Man God Uses is a book of consecration. You read it and you become a vessel unto God. This generation is the God that man uses to achieve his own objective. Yeah, because we use God today for all kinds of things, but that's not my focus, and I really don't want to stray. But this will help to weed out what shouldn't be in your life. Now, 1 Peter chapter 1 is where you were. Having been born again, not of what? Talk to me. This is teaching, instruction. Having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but what? Incorruptible seed, and then he defines that seed, the word of God, which lives and abides forever. What he means is that you can be born again by either corruptible seed or incorruptible seed. And you say it's still a born again experience? Yes. But one won't last. You fade away with time. The other will last. Are you getting what I'm saying? Because the quality of the seed. So what is corruptible seed that can lead to salvation? I make it easy for you. If you come to Jesus, all your problems will be solved. Now you say, well, that's incorruptible seed. Is it really? Is that what Jesus preached about his life and his message? He said, come and follow me, and he that takes his, if you must be my disciple, you must carry your cross daily and follow me. That's the salvation he introduced to us. It's called a cross-carrying salvation. Now, but you don't want to carry any cross. And it's not saying carry a weight. What he's saying is that the cross is a symbol of crucifixion, which means if you must follow me, you must die every day. But you want to live every day. Come unto me and take my yoke. And what is it about my yoke when he qualifies it? It is easy, and my burden is light. What is a yoke? If you tie a dog, you chain it, it is yoked. You chain it to a pole, it is yoked to a pole. So even if you come and the dog is excited, it gets to a point it can't go beyond. So it has liberty, but within boundaries. So it is free and yet bound. I don't think you get it. So tell your neighbor you are free and yet you are bound. Because freedom is a burden itself. Are you getting what I'm saying? If I gave you a gun and I say you can do anything you want with it, or you have a license to a gun, how many of you know that's a huge responsibility to hold one? Because if Pastor Nicholas annoys you, you can as well, this is where the burden is. Why don't I kill him? Are you talking to me? Am I talking to you? Can you feel me? Why don't I? So many times we make promises to people that God didn't make. We get them born again. We tell them, once you give your life to Christ, all your sorrows are over. And then they come into Christ and they realize that there are battles to fight. Is a man, he himself is a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. There are battles to fight, and suddenly they begin to be frustrated. I tell you that when I give my life to Christ, I can't remember what the man preached. But I know what that message did to me. That message has not been corrupted for how many years? 32 years. Can't touch it. That's called incorruptible seed. Wow. So ask the question, have I ever thought in 32 years of turning back? Not even once. And let me bring it to balance. Have I been discouraged along the way? Yes. But to turn back and go and collect my life. Because if you can give your life to Christ, you can say, I no do it again. The thought just, it can't even enter my mind. Because in an instance of time, a drug addict was broke, had his chains of drug addiction broken away from him. There's nothing you can, too real, too deep. And it was the message that I heard. People had preached to me before. Months before, brother preached to me, a Christian brother. The seed, I don't know what seed. It was fearful message. I told him, I let him finish. I said, Brother Augustine Mukoro, I said, thank you for sharing this message. You know, I'm a child of the devil. I told him, if I die now, I'll go to hell. But you see this thing you said? It's not me and you. And I said that out of the sincerity of my heart. When I said it, I wasn't trying to mock it. No, I was honest. When I said I'm a child of the devil, I knew. I wasn't looking for him to bless me. I was looking at how he could use me. That was my story. February the 8th, 1987. I like to share my story. It may not be your story, and yours doesn't even have to follow that path. But I still know the man who preached that message. 30-something years later, he's still a brother. No title. He has not embraced the title craze. He's still as simple and as humble as you can ever imagine. Recently, we had a conversation with him. Because you've got to look back to the instruments that God used to raise you. You don't graduate from school and burn the school down. Your teachers will never be far from you. But if you don't look for them, you won't find them. See, sometimes I wonder how I get where I get, because that's really not my text. But it's the word of the kingdom that for me matters. Now let's look at Galatians chapter 1 and let's read something there. Because this is your year of Ross's Lighthouse. One major thrust that will drive everything we do is spiritual formation. Can be raising people who are ignorant of the word of God, don't know their left from their right. They that know their God, they shall be strong and shall do exploits. Paul, an apostle, not from men. You can be an apostle. You see, these are moments. I try to run away from certain things, but you need to hear. You can be an apostle of men. Because today, from men, is a title today. Is an ascension gift in Ephesians chapter 4. Everybody, but not everybody, lots of people today are longing to be apostles. It's title. Not from men, nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. And all the brethren who are with me to the churches of Galatia. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from which evil age? This present evil age. According to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I marvel. No Marvel comics. That you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to what? Another or a different gospel. So he highlights that there's a different gospel. There's a word of the kingdom and there are other words. There's a gospel of the kingdom and there are other gospels. Which is not another. So it's another gospel, but it's inconsequential. But there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. Now, this is boldness here that we're reading. Even if we... Now, we've preached to you. So if we come back to you as humans... Or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let them be accursed. That's like placing a curse on them. Another gospel. It was at one of our meetings, I was showing you a picture with a special oil with a label. Can you remember what the oil said? So shall I remember? It's a special oil. Stay away from my man oil. Yeah. As another gospel. Small bottle. But you buy it, you put small hair, put small. And when you meet the man, you put it on his head. Every woman will stay away from him. If you believe that, you may be going to hell. I didn't say you are going. I said you may be going. Is that the gospel? That is what? Another gospel. But look at what Paul says. Let them be accursed. Jesus, is that why Jesus died? What is the difference between, see, your husband doesn't love you. Somebody tells you, I'll pray over a bottle of oil. just put 2 drops in his food as you serve him food. You and a witch, what's the difference? Because what you're saying is that you will make someone change their mind when the Holy Spirit is the mind changer. And how many of you know how long it's been taking the Holy Spirit to even change your mind? Talk to me now. And you're still... So you put 2 drops, he eats the rice. Cham! What did you call it? Kopnomi. I know, it's from your side. And go to Cross River. You know, someone said this to me, that if you go to Cross River at Akwa Ibom and you are single, youth service, you can never come back the same. You must marry someone from there. Now, that may be fable or whatever. I'm not saying that's gospel, but you can hold it in your pocket if you are going there. I say hold in your pocket and compare notes, because they have a way of treating you well. They're hospitable people. I've been there many times. They're nice. They're cautious. They're just very friendly. So I'll just charge. Just say, do you not have been loving you since? I wish those things, if they had any validity, would even help us love God more. Do you get what I'm saying? Yeah. Love him. You won't find those kind of things because it latches onto the greed that is in us. Have you ever drink this water and the love of God will overwhelm you? It won't sell. It can't sell. You just be loving God anyhow. After drink, have you ever seen it? The market no go sell. No go move. You don't want to love God. You want all kinds of things to happen. Abracadabra. The more you see, the less you understand. Inexplicable miracles. Yesterday, I was in Nairania. Tomorrow, by next day, I became a billionaire. How did it even mean? I don't know. What happened? A lot just entered my account. Better go to the bank and find out before Code of Conduct Bureau. Because that's what everybody's fearing now. Before they tell you didn't declare your assets. Are you getting what I'm saying? You better go. I will go and check. I received a phone call today and I saw Estonia. You know what I didn't answer it because I don't know anybody there. Estonia. Then the call came in again and I picked it up. I said, let me even pick. We have a software we're trying to say. I say, me, software. But even we, if an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you, let him be accursed. Verse 9. As we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I still please men, I would not be a bond servant of Christ. So let me show you. Look, the foundation upon which Christian life is built is upon the foundation of the Word of God. The reason why there is the Acts of the Apostles is so that we can understand the template upon which the early church was built, because we're going to be built upon that same foundation of apostles and prophets. We can't introduce our own ideas into his word and call it gospel. If not, I will tell all of you to bring sand to church next week. And what will we call the service, Pastor Gabriel? I know you have ideas. Call it sandy, spiritual sandy service. You lift up your sand, I'll pray. You say, God has given you the earth. Just hang it by your door. Your faith will move from Christ to that talisman. In Matthew chapter 13, and where we've, all of this is locking us down to, and I said this last week, there were four different kinds of soils upon which the word of the kingdom was sown. Incorruptible seed, accurate word. This word was not defiled by, it's not the born out of the whims and caprices of men, not at all. You know, I also like to pause here because these are my own personal reflections. I remember, and I share this story with you, I went into an electronic, well, it was one of these stores in the U.S., and I didn't know they had like a, what you call this, it's not called spiritual section. You see spiritual section. So I went there, and I saw a book that had a title like, Living the Highest Quality of Life, under spiritual section. 1 + 1 = 2. So I looked at the author, Deepak Chopra. And I, you know, you quickly want to go through. And I clicked on the first, just somewhere in the middle, and it said, there are different levels of life. There is the soulish life. The thing is resonating. There is the physical life. It's connecting. There is the spiritual life. And the spiritual life is the highest level of life. Is that not gospel? Is that not, can't you see it in the word? And then he started talking about how to ascend to that highest plane. And how you sit in a particular position and you enter the astral dimension. Drop the book as if I was holding hot iron. But today that author is a very popular author in the Western world. And people will read it and they think, it's the gospel. It's not too far. Any slight deviation from truth, you're already in error. But it may take you 10 years for you to realize how far you've gone. Can I use isosceles tri? What's an isosceles? You know, I can call some things I don't even remember. Okay, triangle. Let's not get into the complications. A triangle has how many sides? 3 sides. That's why it's triangle. Then it also has 3 angles. Hypotenuse, what? Opposite and adjacent. If you take a line off the horizontal line in any direction, you may not see much. 1 degree at this angle does not show much of a deviation. Just 1 degree out of 90. Does it show much? No. But when you extend your hypotenuse for 1 mile at the, is that now the adjacent? At the end of that line, when you check the deviation from the horizontal, you'd have moved far. That's how error is. It usually is not much. It's 1 degree. It's half a degree. But when it's extended over a distance, you then see that you've left the horizontal. So when you say, it's not much, it's not much of a problem. The difference is not much. Even God works with these kind of things. Is prayer not prayer? Anybody can pray for you and lay hands on you. They transfer wrong spirit. On the 4 different kinds of grounds, 3 of them did not produce fruit, only 1. And we're looking at the third one, verse 22. Maybe we should just jump. Now, he who receives seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world, we looked at that last week, and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. We spent time and we also took time to pray so that we could unburden ourselves from what? The cares of this world. God does not expect you to carry cares in your heart. If you remember, he said we should cast our cares unto him. So if you're casting it unto him, you're not carrying it in your heart. But you know, today, my focus is on, because he says the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches. And I want to spend a few moments and focus on the word deceit, because it calls it what? The deceitfulness of riches, which means riches have the capacity to deceive. I know you didn't know that, because we live in a G-boy world. Huh? Which one is G-boy? Yahoo? You have Yahoo Plus? You have Yahoo Plus Plus? And then I hear you now have G-boy as new level. Those ones are Ogbologbo of them all. So why is it that today our society is plagued by people who are crafty and who engage in mail fraud? Why is 419? Why is it that Nigerians especially have mastered the art of deceit? You don't know that? Guys will date girls to deceive them and just milk them for money. Is a trend too. You're finding younger guys marrying older women too, because they are settled. I've even seen pastors who did it. The young pastor is sent to go and start a church. Things are tough. He meets a woman 15 years older. She has a job. She has a house. She has a car. He says, marriage is good. Is the cares of this world. That's the foundation of it. Are you with me? Are we going somewhere? I have a few minutes to just wrap this, down. The truth is that riches can deceive and lie to you. I always like to bring things into balance. God's desire for his people is abundance. You can't take it away. Not even Daddy Freeze. You can't take it away. The reason why giving and the church has been under a lot of attack is because of the abuse that has gone on for long from the pulpit. Where the priority is what the pastor can put in his pocket. That's the reason why. If things were done in accordance with the word of God, we won't have all kinds of people coming out today and destroying the foundations and especially eroding spiritual values from the hearts of people. Years before a Daddy Freeze will come up and make noise, I'd preached about tithing in this house. And I said it is not by compulsion. It is a reflection of your love to God. God is not a hard taskmaster who's holding a whip. And if somebody gives you 100 naira, you don't drop one naira, you say, bam! You're wicked. I will curse you. We give to him because we love him. I love him too much not to want to give to his cause, not to want to give of the abundance that is given to me this year alone in this January. I know this. I know what I've given to God. And not just here. Because when the word of God is coming, you think it's only to you that is coming. God says, I'm bringing abundance and harvest. And you need to do X, Y, Z. So I won't do. So only you will enter. And yet I'm the one that he showed the dream. No. I plug in myself. Just be traffic warden telling everybody going. And they will be entering. You'll be on the outside. No way. But you know, if we go back to the book of Genesis, what led to the fall of man was deceit. That's it. The woman stood by the tree and the serpent engaged her. And I want to ask a question that those of you who are very spiritual should be able to help me answer. Does the deceived person know that they are deceived while they are being deceived? See, When you are under deception, do you know that you are deceived? If you had met Eve after that conversation, before she put the fruit in her mouth, and you have said to her, you have been deceived, what will she tell you? You are a liar. God deceived us. He didn't tell us the truth. Now we have found the truth. He is the deceiver. That serpent has opened our eyes. But yes, she was under deception. The only person who was not deceived was Adam. He knew what God said. It was clear to him. And that's why Paul writing would say that Eve was deceived in the transgression. 1 Timothy 2:14 clearly spells it out. But Adam was not deceived. He knew it was wrong, and yet he tagged along. But for Eve, the serpent, that wasn't what I said, 1 Timothy, and Adam was what? Wasn't deceived. But the woman being deceived fell into transgression. So even God, if God has showed up, die it to say you have been lying. Now we know the truth. Deception. So, now this is where rubber meets the road. Ask your neighbor, right now, where you are you being deceived? And they must answer you. Huh? So, what's the answer? Okay, it's complex. Let's use the language you know. Boy and girl, you are in a relationship. You're not married yet. If you're married, you're beyond deception. I mean, you can. We have tied the knot. You can still be deceived, but you are deceived in a cage. But imagine you're in a relationship. And for those of you who are, what makes you think you are not being deceived in that relationship? Now you are going to tell me, I'm not. I know the guy. I know the girl. It takes truth and the Holy Spirit for you to come to a place where you say, ah, I was deceived. And you would usually say, I was deceived and I didn't know. That's what Eve said. After she, and the husband, she was fully persuaded. God doesn't want you to be like him. That's why he hid this part. He said, don't eat the fruit, because he doesn't want competition. Once you eat it, you begin to challenge him. So he said, don't eat. But this is where the real power is. The Bible says she took of the fruit and she ate. When deception has taken hold of you, every contrary thing you hear, you will push it aside. Say, ah, this is good. The Bible says, when she saw that the tree was good for food, before then, she didn't see. Deception changes your perception. Changes how you see things. If there's anything God intends to do in you in this season, it is that he wants to give you an accurate perception of riches. Because if you don't have the right perception and he begins to fulfill his word in your life, you will abuse it. Somebody will say, I can only marry one wife. Because you don't have money. That's not an absolute statement. It's not necessarily applied to you, but I've seen people who said that. And when money came and they realized they can afford to, even as Christians, they took a second wife. How does material wealth deceive us? Simply put, by making promises it cannot keep. Money promotes itself as having the answer to every problem. That's the way. And please, be real with me. How many of you have thought, just here, how many of you have thought, if I only had a little more money, they would respect me in this church? I mean, yeah, okay, don't lift your hand up. Just they will hear me. That's how money deceives. The reason I'm not being productive is because I live in Lugbe. If I was living in Asokoro, I would be very productive. I had see many people living there nothing comes out of their lives. Money makes promises it can deliver. But yet, that's where the trust of many people is. Am I talking to you? I've spent time enough on this earth. I've spent time enough interacting with people. Young, middle age, maybe some old people. I've learned from the aged. I don't want to say... I've seen people lose their wealth. I have one close to me. The first time I will eat in a restaurant at Park Lane in London. If you don't know Park Lane, you play Monopoly. Or you didn't play. You don't know Monopoly. I come here, you don't know. What were you playing as a child? Koso? Or are you? That's what you are playing. Huh? Monopoly is a board game. And it's about real estate. So did you? God bless you for playing. You see three seeds, you pack it. 1, 2, 3. Cha. That's Ayo. That's what you played. And it's a real estate. I mean, game, it derives from the United Kingdom. So you have Bond Street. Those are the high-end properties. Mayfair, Park Lane, Fenchurch Station, Old Kent Road, Knightsbridge is not there. That's modern version of Monopoly. Maybe they've modified it. But it's basically about real estate. The most expensive places where you can build and buy lots is Mayfair and Park Lane, if you remember Monopoly. My uncle took me to Park Lane for lunch. When I saw the menu, I didn't recognize anything inside. It was... I'm even trying to... You know when you're trying to pronounce all those French... So they put menu in my hand. Bush boy from Africa. I wasn't a bush boy. And even in my enlightenment, you know, reach that level. So when I looked, I didn't recognize anything. So I waited for them to order. When they came to me, I said, the same thing. Na me una one shame. When they brought the food, to eat it became issue. Because it really didn't look nice. I had to, are you enjoying your meal after they have spent that kind of money? You say yes. lived, flew first class right through his life. Money was nothing to him. He lived in Nigeria. He dry cleaned his suits in Paris. And let me put this caveat. He made his money legitimately. I tell you this, it wasn't buru-buru. He lost it all. I don't know. It's better you are never at that level. Coming down from that level is the reason why there's a high suicide rate in the Western world. When you find mega corporations go through all kinds of financial scandals, you find their CEOs pick a gun, psh, bam, because to imagine leaving that level and coming down where you are nobody because of what riches promised you that he could not deliver. Pow! Don't want to be there. You don't. Is anyone still with me this afternoon? Wealth, riches makes us think our value lies in how much we're able to accumulate. It promises to provide a type of comfort and rest and abundant pleasure that can only be found in the presence of the Lord. That, but it will promise you that. Money says, if you get enough of it, you will have happiness, security, significance. Those who build high fences and put security around their houses, they travel on Kaduna Road, they kidnap them. With all their money. And the kidnappers collected their own share. So what security does he really give you? Money promises, but only God can provide. You need to, it will make promises. Money can buy medicine without health. Money can buy a house, but not a home. Money can buy or provide companionship, but not friends. Entertainment, but not happiness. Food, but not an appetite. A bed, but not sleep. A crucifix, but not a savior. The good life, but not eternal life. If money could buy eternal life, honestly, we are finished. Because some people would have bought everything. Especially now. And now sell it at an exorbitant rate. Black market, eternal life. And even with that, you will queue. Aren't you thankful that? You can't hoard it and say, I'm the custodian of eternal life. You can't accept Jesus through me. Who told you? Every man has direct access to him. You can talk to him without your pastor and he will hear you and answer you. I want to ask you a question. Why will a woman sell her body? You You know what I'm talking. I'm not saying sell her body for sex. Why? Talk to me. Why? For money. What are the reasons? Okay, let's put it this way. What pushes a woman, or what will push a woman to use her body, to offer her body for sex? Self-esteem? Maybe abuse at a young age, and therefore you feel so defiled and so horrible, your self-worth is reduced. You just say, look, I just threw myself out there. Yeah, that happens. What else? Fame, power. Women would do that. It happens around us. See, I've never reasoned with a prostitute before. I get what I'm saying. But I've seen many of them years ago in the city of Kaduna. See, I learned something valuable. A prostitute has no shame. We went on evangelism and we're trying to reach out to our neighborhood. You were there. So you were there, Pastor Shola. And so we will start evangelism at 10 p.m., about 9:30, 10 p.m. to like 4 a.m. It was red light district. Go from street to street, speaking to them, leading to Christ, getting their details with an aim to pull them out. Then we got to this place where you had Ogbologbo prostitutes. These ones were in their 40s. They've been there for a long time. They're called seasoned prostitutes. And they had been seeing us in that environment. They knew we were a church. So they were waiting for us. I'm not sure you remember. As we approach, they say, Ashewo pastors, then go come use us. Now then they come again and say they won't preach. And I'm like, see. Nobody told us, find your level. Evangelism ended straight. You think, no. Those were a different levels. The ones we had seen, you talk to them, they would hear you. You pray. These ones, Ashewo pastors. Now we know them. Now here, then they come. They don't finish now. Then say, then they preach. Now lie. Lord, the assignment is over for tonight. So we met this girl, and we've done that here too. Done that here. We met this girl, and there's a reason why we stopped reaching out. You understand? We met this girl, and by the next day, I remember myself, Pastor Joe, I don't know who else was there. We actually went to the brothel where she was staying to pick her out. It was a fight with the owner of the brothel because she pays rent. It's a hotel brothel, really. She pays rent. And for the man, we are spoiling business. But we stood the ground, picked her, and rehabilitated her. My sister-in-law's place, I think she had a BQ with space at the back. She was coming to church. But after a while, the money she was making from sleeping around, she was no longer making it. We were feeding her, we were giving her allowance. It's like, if I go out, I know how much I can make. She Said she was traveling to Kano, and that's how she disappeared. The cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches. You know, every time I've read this scripture, I never saw the connection between the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches. They are joined together. It's the cares of this world that actually leads you into being deceived by riches. So watch this. Things are tough. Here in Abuja, when we went to Gimbia Street at night, we did it, at, I think, 2 weekends or 3 weekends in a row. You meet. So we go to this kind of like bar, kind of nightclub-y kind of place. Wasn't it? Huh? Ibiza. You were part of the evangelism team. Okay. I couldn't remember, but the way the name came out quickly. I remember it was Evangelist Becker and myself. And we saw this girl who was sitting on a table alone. So we went to sit by her. And we began to have a conversation. So what are you doing here? Well, she said she was bored. She just came out to have a drink. She was drinking Star. We didn't condemn her for a Star. Because if you want to reach out to people, you can't. So we began to share the gospel with her. And she began to cry. Do you know what she said? She said, I just came out of midweek fellowship. She went to a church that night. But she left church to go and sell her body. I'm not lying. She said, the Holy Spirit must have sent you people here. She speaks in tongues. So why are you doing this? She said, things are tough. I need to. My parents can't sustain me. I'm in University of Abuja. I only come here to make some money at weekends. There was another one. It was in Otaku here. You remember? By the time she saw, she was smiling. She actually was smiling, excited. Like, and when the conversation started, it was like, you people are trying to know that this is how our church also teaches us to evangelize. She was, yes. I don't want to mention the name of the church. So it's kind of like encouraging you guys, but she was there to sell her body on the streets. So how do we get the waters muddied? How does it get that muddied in the lives of people? That you would attend midweek service and leave midweek service to go and sell your body for money. And then on Sunday, you're there too. I met a girl from my hometown, Gimbia Street. I was having a conversation. Where are you from? Why do you want to know? Ekwara State. I say, where Ekwara State? I say, where Nofa? Which house? So I introduced myself. It was as if the ground should. Because you know the families. This girl comes from a relatively decent home. Let me tell you this. Deceitfulness of riches comes out of what cares of this world. You are in serious difficulty. And I'll use the prostitution thing. Or selling your body, let's not call it prostitution. And you feel, 20K will solve my problem. I can go and sleep with a man. Maybe somebody has been putting you under pressure. He will use a condom, so no chance of disease. But at least when I get the 20K, I will solve my problem. I will repent before the Lord. He will forgive me my sin because he's a very forgiving God. And I won't do it again. That's the deceitfulness of riches there. That I can retrace my steps. It's just a little evil. God really does. He won't even mind. Because when life is at stake, doctrine falls. You will find reasons to justify it. And so you go do it. And you collect 20K. And you come and repent before the Lord. I won't do it again. But you see, you have been hijacked by deception. But you know, I can make 100K. If I do 5 days straight, 5 days, I can make 500K. 500K, that's a lot of money. If I can do that, I won't do. God, you know, I won't even. 500K is all I need. All I need. Thank you, Matthew. I will even give you tithe on Sunday. I'll give you 10%. 50. And go make the 500K. You come and drop 50K. You say, the money don't even short. I'm showing you a trajectory. But even those that are younger than me, they are driving car. And me, I'm just roaming the streets. 500K 1 week. Okay, Lord, just 1 month. I will dedicate the month of February. Just after that, I won't do again. I won't. But at least I know I'll get a car. I'll have a house. I will send my CV out so I can get jobs, you know, and be decent in my... Just this one time. Then you go and make the money. You say, Lord, I repent. I'm not. So you are free for March. You are free from April. You're free for May. You haven't gone back. Oh. Then your friend just came out from Dubai. So this Dubai, this going to the abroad. You know, that's how Nigerians say. This the abroad. I want to go to the abroad. Eventually, the summary of it all is that riches deceived you to think that you can manipulate your way to acquire it and escape easily. It's a trap. Before you know, you're counting 10 years. 15 years, 20 years. Not just that, your heart has become so hardened. You don't know the heart can be hardened. And even when you're hearing truth, as it's passing through in here, it's coming out the other. Nothing pricks you. Your conscience is so dead, so seared. The way of a prostitute is hard. The way of a sinner is hard. The way of a G-boy is hard. Yahweh is hard. First Timothy. Chapter 6. Verse 9. Let's read it in the Living Bible translation. King James, okay. But people who long to be rich. Now that's not saying don't desire abundance. This is speaking about those who are desperate to be rich. This life, I must be rich. I must be. That desperation, what happens to them? They soon begin to do all kinds of wrong things to get money. Things that hurt them and make them evil-minded and finally send them to hell itself. For the love of money, not money, but the love of it is the first step towards what? All kinds of sin. Money is to be used, not loved. It's a tool. Are you getting what I'm saying? Just like everything. Look, let me tell you what will help you in life. Simple definitions. What's a car? It's a tool. See, once you leave it at that level, it doesn't matter whether you're driving a Land Cruiser. It doesn't, who cares what you are driving? But it's a what? A tool. The day it stops being a tool, you are a fool. Once in you, you know that's what it is. It is to move you from point A to B comfortably. That's fine. Don't you? The comfort is important. Once that is what a vehicle is to you, you are good. Once it becomes a tool for oppression or an instrument for oppression, you are a fool. I was speaking to my pastor some time back, and he said something. It had never hit me. He had just built his house. And he said, every time I dedicate my house, I don't dedicate my house while it's furnished. I dedicate it empty. This is why. And this is his own version. So this is not gospel. But you can glean from the principle. He said, when you dedicate a house that's fully furnished, by the time you have cut the tape to the glory of God, as you are taking people through, is your ego and your pride. Oh, this bed came from Italy. It's one of a kind. You know, this leather actually is from crocodiles that are grown in Australia. You know, this one, it didn't cost much. The stool, each one is 750,000. They're just four. It's not much. It's 3 million. You dedicated in the name of the Lord, but your pride is reflected in that building from the beginning to the end. And you hear that, you keep it. Day you dedicate, come, see empty house. There's nothing to describe. You say, no furniture is on the way. So it doesn't allow pride to show itself. The clothes you wear. Once it moves beyond being a covering to present you in a decent way, a pastor who is my friend, is watching him on TV. 30 minutes of precious airtime. Paid for by the church that he was pastoring. And he talked about his wardrobe for 30 minutes. I watched it, not that they told me, because I was waiting for the message. One of my sons in the faith took me to his boutique. He said, Pastor, touch anything you want is yours. He said, I touched this suit, 100K. I touched this one, 150. I touched this one. I touched this. I touched this. I touched shoe. I touched shirt, 150. He packed everything. He gave it to me. What God can do for me, he can also do for you. Can I hear somebody say, This was 17 years ago. And I said, what? I hope he has changed. Can we go down? No, let's finish this. The love of money is a first step towards all kinds of sin. Some people have even turned away from God because of their love for it. And as a result, have pierced themselves with many sorrows. And then it says to Timothy, O man of God, run from all these evil things and work instead at what is right and good, learning to do what? Trust him. And do what? Love others and to be patient and gentle. He has made it all simple. Let's go down. Because if this is not weeded out of your life, you will oppress all of us. As God brings increase, we are in trouble hanging around you. Come on, oppressor of men. Misuse, abuse. Take me down to, I think, verse 17. Verse 17. Tell those who are rich. Ask your neighbor, are you rich? You know, I gave a definition of being rich. When was that? Was it on Sunday? No. It was at one of our meetings during the week. And I said, yes, Monday. What does rich mean? When you have more than enough that you can throw away and you won't lose sleep, you are rich. We have 250 kg bags of rice. The rat can even be taken from one bag. And you will not know you are rich. When I was off campus, I was living in what you call Face Me, I Face You Too. You know, room and parlor, that kind of thing. That's room and parlor. I don't know whether that's what's Face Me, I Face You. A room parlor compound behind, one toilet, everybody sharing. Okay, it's not Face Me and Face You. Mine is room and parlor. And in the corner of my bedroom was a big basket, one of these woven baskets, where I keep my food, yam, all those kind of things, you know. One night, I woke up around 3 a.m. There was a rat. See, not a rat as big as a cat. Because there were bushes around. That one that Stephanie and Co. Where's Stephanie tonight? That's lat. So there was a lat. So I'm lying on my bed. Truth, I'm lying on my bed. I'm telling you about riches. I'm lying on my bed. I wake up. I see this lat in my bedroom. I mean, it's real big. because of its size, you know, when I woke up and I saw it, first of all, my mind told me, this cannot be real. You are dreaming. I'm being honest. So I thought it was a dream. You know, so you are kind of like saying, what's God trying to show me in this dream? Now you're laughing, but I'm serious. So I just went back and slept off. In the morning, I said, was it reality or not? This is where I saw the rat. So we got a stick. I didn't know. So they pulled the basket. The rat was sleeping. It had eaten cocoyam. That when we pulled the basket, it was just there. The stomach. And trust me, I'm not exaggerating. When the stick hit it, that was when, but it was too late. It was dead. Because I was rich, the yam carried, the rat carried cocoyam, drew it from the basket into a corner. If not that I saw it, would I have known that my cocoyam was missing? Simon Unongo was a member of the church. We had thrown it away. We made a mistake. When I told him, he said, where is it? Where is it? Because for him, that's meat. You are rich when things can disappear and you won't even know until after a long time. You know, even your shirt, your clothes, you can't even tell. It's later. You say, I'm looking for one shirt. I can't find it. You are rich. But rich has different grades. Okay, so that's level one. You know, you could be. But it says, tell those who are rich not to be proud. And here's the key, not to trust in their money, which will soon be gone. Because once you trust in it, God and money cannot compete. God will try and show you that he's more powerful than what you are trusting in. You cannot serve God and mammon. But their pride and trust should be in the living God. This is the switch. It should be in the living God who always richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. He's not against you enjoying things. But he's against the things that is given for you to enjoy, control your life. Next verse. Tell them to use their money to do what? To do good. God said is bringing abundance and he will instruct us on where to sow it. Look, do good. They should be rich in what? In good works, not rich in riches. Should give happily to those in need. Always being ready to share with others whatever God has given them. By doing this, they'll be storing up real treasure for themselves in heaven. It is the only safe investment for eternity. And they'll be living a fruitful Christian life down here as well. Which means that the word of the kingdom will bear fruit. Good place for us to close. We'll see as we find grace to be able to deepen these things, the deceitfulness of riches. I want us to pray. You know, scripture says, trust in the living God. Let your faith be in the living God, not what you possess. not what you own, not what you drive, not where you live. Those things are secondary. If you are a son of the kingdom, those things are not what defines or determines who you are. But let your faith be in the living God who richly gives you all things to enjoy. That's what God doesn't want to compete with riches, not with mammon in your life. Can we stand on our feet this evening and say, look, Lord, in any way in which I've put my trust in money, in wealth, and I've been driven by it, a little more, a little more, a little more, I'll be comfortable, a little more, a little more, and I keep gravitating, expressing my faith in riches. Lord, forgive me. Today I place my faith in you. You are my provider. You are my source. And you richly provide for me. Richly, everything that I need for my enjoyment. I refuse to trust in uncertain riches. When you look at your bank account, sometimes you see some good money there that can last you a year or two. Your confidence just suddenly receives a boost. It shows that your trust is in what is in your account. Let your trust be in Almighty God, that even if your account reads zero, you won't lose your joy. You won't lose your faith. You won't lose your hope. You will still find joy in the Lord. You'll still be excited because you trust Him and you know that He gives you richly all things to enjoy. Pray that God will reconfigure your heart, that you'll be willing to distribute. Everybody can give. It's just that we give according to the measure of the blessing of God in our lives. God, Paul said, my God will supply all your need according to His riches in glory. So such as I have, give I thee. We all can give. And pray that Lord would, the God Almighty will give you a generous heart. A heart that's disposing to helping people. You meet people in need. Even from that which you have, you understand that's a call to generosity. That you will not be high-minded, but you'll be willing to support, willing to help, willing to give. Lebo kosto frakashtike luso brande kele. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. Thank you. Thank you for cleaning out. This is house cleaning. Cleaning our hearts from covetousness, the deceitfulness of riches. Lord, we will not be deceived. No. Not by wealth, not by money, not by riches, not by the things of this life. But our faith and confidence will be in you and you alone. Thank you, Father. We'll give you praise. Bless the work of our hands. Let our labor produce great fruit. You said we will not labor in vain nor bring forth for trouble. We thank you. We thank you for all the things that you provide for us. You are our provider. The God who sees. The God who knows. Thank you, Father. Have you been blessed tonight? Let's get out our offerings. Tithes for those who are tithing. Special gifts for those who have made commitments to the Lord. And the Lord will multiply your seed soon. It will bring tremendous harvest. It will cause more grace to abound towards you. So that you, in all things, having all sufficiency in all things, will abound unto every good work. Father, we thank you. We give you praise for today. In Jesus' precious, matchless name. Amen. This Sunday, we'll be starting our Lighthouse Read the Bible Challenge. So we started this Sunday. We'll read the Bible through in 1 year. So for those of you who don't receive our publication, our devotional, we want you to leave your email addresses behind. If you've got friends who you want to receive this, you can put the video on, play it, so we can see these announcements as we...